Hello and welcome to New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I am Dr. Wendy Van Dilla, naturopathic physician. I am your host. Today in the studio with me is Dr. Stefan Ripich, who is also a naturopathic physician and a certified nurse practitioner. Welcome, Dr. Ripich.
Thanks, Wendy. Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
Oh, you bet. And please tell us, what brought you into naturopathic medicine? From you started off being a nurse practitioner, right, for about 10 years and doing hospital work?
That's right. I'm one of those rare people who really knew from a very early age exactly what I wanted to do. I even have little pictures of me at Halloween dressed as a doctor. I always wanted to go into healthcare, but because I was always working my way through school, I had to take it incrementally. So first I became a registered nurse, and then I went back to school and became a nurse practitioner. And even then, I was interested in holistic care, so I stitched together two different master's degrees to become a nurse practitioner to take care of the body and a clinical specialist in psychiatric and mental health nursing to take care of the mind.
Wow.
And when I graduated, I was one of only 40 people in the United States who sat for that certification because it was sort of a different perspective.
Mm-hmm. And very different.
I went into the hospital system and worked there for about 10 years, and it became apparent that the next step for me was to return to medical school. And as I looked around at conventional medical school, I just thought, this is a recreation of what we have in the hospital system. This is really a pharmacy sort of driven illness model institution, and I wanted something different. I had been studying all kinds of herbal medicines and that as picking that up.
Mm-hmm.
So I decided to go to a fully accredited four-year naturopathic medical school at Southwest College in Tempe, Arizona. And that's how I got here.
When did you graduate from that program?
I graduated in January of 2005 and moved here to Santa Fe to join an existing practice. And then on April Fool's Day of 2006, which actually ended up being sort of a metaphor, I came into my own practice here in Santa Fe.
Okay. And where in Santa Fe is your office?
I'm over on Louisa Street at 1300 Louisa Street, conveniently located exactly next to McGee Mortuary. So, you know, if it doesn't work out with me, we can send you next door.
Well, there's another mortuary just across the street, isn't
That's
there?
Right.
So
yeah, I thought,
you have a choice.
Anyway, it's a great practice, isn't it? Great office. And I make that joke about the mortuary, but the truth is I've never been so proud to be a physician in my life. I've just seen amazing, amazing results, and it's
well, you're
such
also,
a blessing.
You're also close to Whole Foods and the, what is that, Perez, an exercise of pool.
That's
nice
right,
facility.
Salvador Perez,
yes.
I make plenty of referrals there, too.
So what do you see the huge difference between a holistic approach and a hospital approach?
Well, really, the differences between conventional medicine and naturopathic medicine are primarily philosophical. We both agree on what constitutes good medicine. We both agree on what constitutes reasonable ways of knowing good medicine when we see it.
Mm-hmm.
Where we tend to differ is in conventional medicine, illness is typically seen as this invader that comes in from the outside, whether it's a number on a blood pressure sheet or a lab report or a tumor or some other entity, it's some non-host problem that you aim your intervention at.
Something that can be removed.
Something that can be addressed. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
A target.
Mm-hmm.
And in naturopathic medicine, we tend to see symptoms just as a sort of outer reflection of an inner imbalance. And we borrow a metaphor from Chinese medicine. You know, in traditional Chinese medicine, they don't believe in germ theory at all. They say when the water becomes stagnant, mosquitoes are attracted to it. And you can swat at the mosquitoes, you can surgically remove them, you can treat them with an herb, you can do a spinal adjustment, whatever you do, as long as you're aiming at mosquitoes, you're misguided. If you want the mosquitoes to go away, you make the water flow. And in naturopathic medicine, that's what we do. We see that your body has this enormous healing power, and everything we do is aimed at getting you into the best possible place for this inherent healing ability to just flow. And the other second philosophical difference between conventional medicine and us is sort of this. If you believe that the target of your intervention is this bug and your bullet is penicillin, then it doesn't matter who gives you your penicillin. Just that you get penicillin. And when you think about it, that explains how we could have a healthcare system where it would be possible for you to go to a clinic and never see the same doctor twice. Because it doesn't matter. As long as you get penicillin, you will be considered to be treated. In naturopathic medicine, we believe that real healing only comes when there is a therapeutic relationship, when the physician and patient are in agreement about what this treatment would look like, how it would be beneficial, that the treatment has to match the patient. That's why we could come up with 10 different remedies for headache. Whereas conventional medicine just wouldn't see it that way. But we would match the remedy to the patient. We would understand the patient's environment, the patient's family, and work in that sort of context. So for me, that's why I became a naturopathic doctor. It was just resonant with what made sense to me.
Absolutely. But you still use your nurse practitioner
training. Oh, that's right. Don't kid yourself.
How do they mix?
Look, I'm very proud of the time I spent in those hospitals. I spent time in great hospitals with brilliant physicians, some of the best minds today, and conventional medicine has its place. I'm not going to deny that there were plenty of times that patients come in and I write prescriptions. And if you come into my office and you're 104 degrees and your tonsils are full of pus, it's very likely that you will go out, that interaction will resemble what would happen in a conventional office. But the difference is I bring you back and say, so what happened to your immune system? How did you get caught off guard? How can we prevent this from happening again? That actually is very consistent with naturopathic philosophy too. And that's that sometimes you have to just be heroic. And there is a place for that. When you come into my office and I think, wow, this looks like appendicitis to me, I send you into the emergency room. There is a place for conventional medicine. And that's why the name of my clinic is The One Medicine.
The One Medicine.
The One Medicine. Mm-hmm. There isn't conventional and alternative. There's just good medicine. And
well,
that's what I want for my patients.
Yeah, and that you have the dual training makes you a unique naturopathic physician in the Santa Fe community.
That's right.
Because you have full prescription rights.
That's right.
That a nurse practitioner has.
That's right. And I can accept insurance too, which makes my care accessible to a lot of people. You know, I was 45 years old when I decided to go back to medical school. I knew I didn't want to recreate a big factory style practice where there was the din of patients flying in and out of the door. My object was always to take care of people and get the medicine out there. So by agreeing to accept insurance, which is part of the April Fool's Day joke.
So what is your practice like? Is it, you said you didn't want the style of a big busy office with lots of patients and people traveling in and out.
So
what did you create here in Santa Fe?
So I have no receptionist, so you come in the door and it's me. I have no secretary, so you dial the phone and I answer.
And you answer. Uh-huh.
I have no nurse, so if you need to get a pill or an injection or something like that, I give it. Mm-hmm. And the bottom line is this: the more staff I hire, the more patients I have to see just to pay their salaries. So I keep it very contained, mm-hmm. and I work, and I spend time, and I listen, and it's a very different experience in the context of sort of a Western conventional sort of practice. I still have an exam table. I still have a blood pressure cuff and stethoscope and mm-hmm. those sorts of things. It's just a different way of doing that. It's an old-timey way. I still make mm-hmm. house calls.
House calls. Wonderful. So if a new patient came to you, what would it be like? How much time would they spend with you?
I try to spend about 45 minutes with a new patient.
Mm-hmm. And that's with you?
With me. Uninterrupted mm-hmm. quality time.
So how do you bill for that?
A new patient visit. It's completely within the guidelines, and it's completely appropriate. I don't think that's the issue. I set my sights a little differently. Mm-hmm. Because I was so much older, it allowed me to change how I did it. If you have a staff full of helpers, then you need to see a lot of patients. Mm-hmm. So I kept things sensible, and it's a different way.
Mm-hmm. But in the conventional way of billing, if you spend 15 minutes with somebody, that's more of a typical interview. And 45 minutes with somebody is more of what somebody is spending with a more extensive treatment, like a surgical procedure. Is that, as a nurse practitioner, can...
No, I don't think that's... Insurance companies are making a slow but steady shift away from that way of thinking.
Oh, good.
And you know what?
Good.
I bill within the guidelines, and I haven't set my sight on that as a primary focus of my practice. My practice is about my people, is about mm-hmm. quality time, about good medicine, mm-hmm. and spending time with them. And it's allowed me to do the kind of medicine I want, and allowed me to pursue projects that I wanted to pursue.
What is your sense about what's wrong with our current medical system? And have you been keeping up with the recent political scene? And what are your comments about that whole subject? And that's a big subject.
Well, you know, it's easy to think that there are some bad doctors in the world who are just pill pushers, and mm-hmm. that conventional medicine is nothing but greed and so on. And to some extent, there are enormous pressures exerting themselves on the healthcare system that are completely unprecedented. But I have worked in that environment. Mm-hmm. I know these physicians are good people. They want to help, but they are constrained by economic factors that are incredible. For example, the change in priority to seeing more patients, the change in priority towards using pharmacy as the first intervention rather than the relationship, and the enormous pressure that the drug companies exert on our healthcare system are unbelievable. This is the only country in the world in which pharmaceutical industries are permitted to advertise directly to consumers and have spent over $500 billion doing that. Can you imagine what that means in terms of our healthcare costs in this country? Something's fishy.
Thank you very much for bringing that point out.
There are
that's a very important point.
That's right. There, are we've gotten all of our priorities turned around, and it's no wonder people are disillusioned when we look at this tragic healthcare reform. Listen, I vote Democrat solidly. I voted for Obama. And this healthcare reform is over 2,000 pages long. Who can make sense of it? Some of the best features of it that we've been looking forward to in terms of pre-existing conditions and all of that won't take place for another 5 years. Mm. It hasn't really closed as many gaps as we had hoped. Consumers try to go to the internet and find what they can find out to take care of themselves because they have to. Unfortunately, one day butter is good, the next day butter is bad. How can they sort through all of that?
Well, I think you've given us a very good resource for sorting through some of this by writing a book. Please tell us about your book.
Yes, you know, diabetes is such an incredible problem in this country.
And especially New Mexico.
One third of the children born after 2002 will be diagnosed with diabetes. This is the first time in the history of mankind. I mean, really, since caveman days, this is the first time that a generation of children will not outlive their parents. One in four people are touched by diabetes, either directly or indirectly, right now. Can you imagine? One in four. And yet, we just keep plodding along with the old solutions. And I got to tell you, this is one area in which conventional medicine is really letting us down. I see a lot of patients, and they are not being taught that type 2 diabetes is controllable and reversible with lifestyle and diet.
And completely preventable.
And completely preventable. And even my type 1 diabetics, I can reduce their insulin intake by 70%. I'll tell you something
staggering. Say that again. The type 1 diabetic,
I can reduce their insulin dependency as much as 70%. I have patients that were eating poorly and had been taught by the American Diabetes Association what their diet should look like, and it was terrible. And by switching into a different way of eating, a different way of living, my patients experienced significant reductions in their medications, and there has never been in my practice one single type 2 diabetic that I have not been able to get off of their medicines. Now, sooner or later, there's going to come some type 2 diabetic who is so entrenched in the illness that I may not be able to get them completely off, but I get people off of their medicines. I change how they live, and my book is called The 30-Day Diabetes Cure. And all the lawyers were like, cure, cure, wait a minute, do you really want to say that? And I said, yes, I do want to say that. So, and if I can't cure you, in 30 days, I will teach you everything you need to know to significantly reverse your diabetes.
And where is this book available?
You can look on the website, and at the time of our taping now, it's just going to printing. It's the 30-day, or it's 30daydiabetescure.com.
Okay. And if they go to your website?
If they go to my website, I better build a link in there. I'm glad you said that. This is evolving as we go along. I think that they can get access to me and to be a patient. Okay. And then I'll put a link in so they can get to the book also.
Okay. And what is your website?
TheOneMedicine.com. TheOneMedicine.com. That about says it all.
It does. It does. And how is your book, The 30-Day Diabetes Cure, how is it different than all the other books that are out there?
It's not a diet. Diets have a beginning, a middle, and an end. And this isn't about that. Every single day, I teach you one thing that you need to do, one thing that you need to implement to change your life forever. And the top of every day has a little short chapter. There's a plus sign or a minus sign on the top of every day. Mm-hmm. On some days, you'll add healthy things in. That's the plus sign. On some days, you'll subtract unhealthy things out of your life. But it's not just about food. Food is a big part of it, of course. But there's also days where you focus on eliminating self-sabotaging behaviors, where you add in support for yourself, where you take away, something unhealthy in terms of sugar, but you'll add back in something healthy in terms of whole grains. And it goes 30 days, day by day, that way, and you live that way for the rest of your life.
That's wonderful.
What else is different about it? It works.
So why wouldn't it work for somebody?
It can't work for people who can't really get engaged and do it. There are some patients who just say, you know, doc, I'd really rather just eat the way I want to eat and take the pill.
Take the pill, yeah.
And for them, I'll still be their doctor. I will still be the only voice in their whole lives that is still ranting and saying, you should be doing this. But I will still stick by them, and I will prescribe the medicines if that's what they choose. Those are the patients who need to come to me the most.
And it sounds like your attitude is that's okay. That's their choice.
It's not their best choice. It's not their highest self.
Okay.
But I won't abandon people just because they're not always acting from their highest selves. God knows I don't always act from my highest self.
We're all working on that.
That's right. We're all working on it, and my job is to be there.
And you've talked about the plus and minus, some of them. Give our viewers another example of something they would see at the top of the page for the 30-day
If
the 30
there was
day
one
cure.
Thing that diabetic patients could do, the most important thing that they would do would be to stop consuming any form of high fructose corn syrup. There was a time in my life when people would ask me, is there one food that you won't eat? And I would say trans fatty acids, margarine. And now everybody knows about that. But what's not getting out about high fructose corn syrup is how fat it makes us, full of abdominal fat. We don't seem to understand why, and that's alarming to me. We do understand that it bypasses conventional metabolic pathways and so tends to go into fat faster. We do understand that it turns off the leptins in your brain, which give you a sense of fullness. There was an interesting study.
Leptins. What are leptins?
Leptins are neurotransmitters that tell you it's time to stop eating.
Those are important.
They are. And when there was a study done of women who were fed different beverages, all of the same caloric content, soda or orange juice or milk or all of that, and then fed a meal, those women who drank high fructose corn syrup before their meal, on average, consumed well over 200 more calories than anyone else at the table because the high fructose corn syrup did that. There was an interesting study at, I think it might have been Princeton, where they fed mice high fructose corn syrup water or cane sugar water, and the high fructose corn syrup mice got 90% fatter. Same caloric intake, they just couldn't stop taking it. So in terms of diabetic patients who are watching the show, do that today, do that now.
And if you need any more convincing, there is an excellent documentary out called King Corn that you can get on Netflix, just download, you don't have to pay for it even, called King Corn, and it talks, it goes through this whole what happens to corn and what it takes to make high fructose corn syrup and all the different products. I mean, it's an excellent documentary. I highly recommend it. It's shocking.
It's also Michael Pollan's work is around that. A lot of people have read his stuff.
And that's a book resource?
Yes, a book resource, Michael Pollan.
What's the name of the book?
Omnivore's Delight is one of them.
Omnivore's Delight.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm so sorry, it's Omnivore's Dilemma.
Dilemma.
Yeah.
Okay. And, this is, what's your opinion of agave? That's kind of hit the market, and people think it's really healthy. What's
your opinion?
It tastes
awfully sweet to me, and I'll tell you, anything that tastes that sweet makes me suspect. And there are so many controversial articles about it now. Oh, it has a very low glycemic index. That's good. But it's not really organic, even though they say it is. That's not good. So I minimize my intake of it. And I frankly minimize my intake of all those kinds of very sweet, fast sugars. Use stevia instead.
And what is stevia?
Stevia is an herb that tends to stimulate the sweet receptors on your tongue and tell you you're getting something sweet, even though it has really no calories itself. So a little bit of it goes a long way.
Mm-hmm.
But once you start having a healthy diet, you'll be amazed how stunningly sweet fresh fruit really starts to taste again. How sweet an apple is, how sweet grapes are. A fresh peach is intoxicating once you get away from all of those things that deaden your palate.
How about salt? I think sugar, salt, and fat seem to be real problem areas in our refined foods and diet.
Yes, well, as you get away from processed foods, your salt intake will fall naturally as you'd go away from those sorts of things. And in terms of fats, well, it's a problem. You gravitate towards healthier fats as you move into a healthier way of eating, and you reduce them. They're certainly not the bugaboo that they were once popularly before. And frankly, that low-fat business, or rather no-fat, was a tragic misunderstanding of your body's workings and metabolism, and people were eating all kinds of crazy foods were fat-free.
Oh, yeah.
So,
do you talk about that in your book?
I do extensively talk about good fats, bad fats, low fat.
Excellent.
All of that.
And for those viewers, I want to remind you that this is New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show. I'm talking with Dr. Stefan Ripich, and he is bringing out a wonderful new resource, a book called The 30-Day Diabetes Cure. And how does somebody reach you? How does somebody get a hold of the book? Tell us again.
Well, you should go to the website, www.30daydiabetescure.com, or you can reach me for an appointment at my office at theonemedicine.com.
Great. And that's here in Santa Fe. And Dr. Ripich is also a certified nurse practitioner and takes most of the major health insurance companies. So thank you very much for being
on
our show.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And for those of you who want to get a hold of either Dr. Ripich or myself, look at the credits at the end of the show for specific phone numbers, websites. And I want to thank my production staff for helping with the show, Doreen Gallegos, Marshall Martinez for doing editing and production, for George Marvin for being my director. I'd like to thank my two camera people, Harvey Morgenbesser and Dr. Natalie Pedro. And I'd like to thank Bill O'Donnell for being my floor director. This is Dr. Wendy Van Dilla with New Mexico's Naturopathic Medical Show.